and raised him up, saying, "Arise, up quickly." And his chains fell off from his hands. And the angel said unto him, "Gird thyself and bind on thy sandals." And he did. And he said unto him, "Cast thy garment about thee and follow me." And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. When they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth unto the city, which opened to them of his own accord. And they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from them. And when Peter was come to himself, he said, "Now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and hath delivered me out of the hands of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews." And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many was gathered together praying. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken, named Rhoda. And when she knew Peter's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate. And they said unto her, "Thou art mad." But she constantly affirmed that it was even so. Then said they, "It is his angel." But Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door, they saw him, and they were astonished. But he beckoned unto them with the hand to hold their peace, declared unto them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, "Go show these things unto James and to the brethren." And he departed and went into another place. Now as soon as it was day, and there was no small stir among the soldiers, what was become of Peter. And when Herod had sought for him and found him not, he examined the keepers and commanded that they should be put to death. And he went down from Judea of Caesarea and there abode. James 5:16. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual and fervent prayer of the righteous man availeth much. Our subject on this afternoon, and I want you to turn to your neighbor while you say this subject. I want you to tell your neighbor, keep on praying. Now, if you're one that's sitting in between two people, turn to the other one and say, keep on praying. Hallelujah. Webster gives the definition, which is the root word of praying, pray. To request in a humble manner. To address God or a God with adoration, confession, supplication, or thanksgiving. In your time, I'm going to give you a little bit, but you can go back in your time and do an in-depth study. But the word of pray in its many forms, whether it's prayers or praying are mentioned 538 times throughout the Bible. That's letting me know we ought to pray. For I believe that prayer is my direct communication with God. And I know that I don't have to wait now until the priest go into the Holy of Holies. I can pray for myself. Do I have a witness in this place? Keep on praying. There are some scriptures that are very familiar to us that really use the word of prayer. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 says, pray without ceasing.
Yes, yes, Lord.
It's letting us know that in everything we ought to pray.
Yes.
Whether it's morning, noon,
yes,
or evening,
yes,
your prayers should be continual.
Yes.
1 Timothy 2:8 said, I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. Philippians 4:6 says, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving let your requests be known unto God. Keep on praying. Matthew 17:21 said, Jesus said, howbeit this kind going out but by prayer and by fasting. Keep on praying. In our scripture text, we begin to realize that there was a famine going on in the land. And Peter has been locked up. But prior to Peter being locked up, they have already killed James. And there was only one reason why Peter wasn't killed. You see, at this time, there was coming the feast of the Passover. And Herod observed the Passover. So he told them, take Peter and lock him in prison. Because you see, after the Passover, I'm going to kill Peter just like I killed James.
Yeah, that's right.
How many of y'all know that the enemy wanted him dead?
Yes, yes.
Because they were preaching Jesus to the Gentiles. And the Gentiles didn't want to be equal. The Jews didn't want the Gentile to be equal with them. Because I don't know if you know, but we were counted as dogs. We was counted as less than human beings. And the set of the Jews began to murmur. It was like, why are the apostles preaching to the Gentiles? They are below us. And if you fast forward time, we just came out of the month of Black History. You see, these were the things that the white folks were saying about the black folk. Why should we use the same restroom they're using? They're beneath us. They're less than human beings. Keep on praying. You see, it was somebody that prayed that allowed us to be where we are today. Hallelujah. You may not know who put those prayers up for you, but somebody was praying.
Yes.
And we understand that we celebrate the feast of the Passover as Easter.
Yes.
Somebody said Easter saved Peter. But how many of y'all know that Easter saved me? Easter saved you.
Yes.
Because if our Lord and Jesus would not have got up out of that grave in 3 days, none of us would have the key to the tree of life. None of us would have been drafted into the tree. Easter saved me. And Peter was in prison, guarded by 16 soldiers. The Bible tells us it was 4 squads of 4 soldiers. 4 times 4 is 16. But how many of y'all know that there was a prayer meeting happening on Peter's behalf? The Bible doesn't give detail about this prayer meeting that was going on at Mary's house. But you see, some saints had got together. Because Herod had already killed James, and the saints didn't want Herod to kill another one of the apostles. So they were beginning to pray unto God. And I don't know, because the Bible doesn't give detail about what they were saying. But I believe that you had some standing in the corner saying, Lord, save our brother. You might have had some standing on the other side of the house saying, Lord, don't let him kill him. You might have had some back, way back in the back by the washroom saying, Lord, deliver him right now. It doesn't tell us that anything else was going on in that house but prayer.
Yes.
Nobody was There was only one thing happening. The saints were praying. That takes us back to the day of Pentecost. You see, when we all get on one accord, things can happen for people in our lives. The saints was on one accord and they were praying for Peter. The saints, I believe, got in touch with God that night. In so much that God told the angel, hurry up and go down into the prison. Go down and see about Peter. God dispatched an angel on Peter's behalf. And you see, the angel came. And the angel touched Peter and told him, said, hey, look, Peter, it's time to get up. It's time to get out of this place. It's time to be set free. Keep on praying. Because the word of God tells us when Peter stood up, the shackles fell off his hands. There was no key needed. Because I heard the phrase that says, it was prayer. Prayer was the key. And the angel said, come on, Peter, put on your garments. Come on and lace up your sandals. Come on, we got to get out of this place. Touch your neighbor and say, keep on praying. Because you see, when they got up to head out, the door swung open to the prison. Somebody said prayer was the key. And faith unlocked the door. Faith opened the doors to the prison. And they ran out of the prison. And Peter was doing this half awake. He was half awake and half asleep. But he followed the angel of God. But the word of God teaches us when Peter came to himself, he found himself in the middle of the street. Then Peter knew right then, I wasn't dreaming. It had to have been God. It had to have been an angel of God that set me free. I just stopped by to tell you to keep on praying. And something told Peter, go on into Mary's house. Peter wasn't aware that the saints was in Mary's house. But Peter went to Mary's house and knocked on the door. And it talks about a damsel that came to see who was knocking on the door. I don't know if y'all remember or not when we used to have the old-fashioned prayer meets. It used to get pretty loud in that place. In so much if you wasn't paying attention, you might have been bumping into your neighbor, but it used to get real loud and real live in the church. I believe that was happening on that night. Everything was loud and it was live. But God had touched one damsel, this young girl, and God had allowed her to hear that Peter was knocking at the door. Keep on praying. She went to see who was knocking at the door. You see, in these days and age, we tell our children, don't you answer that door if I'm not home. Or even if I'm in the bedroom, don't you go open that door if somebody knocks. But I don't believe that was happening here, because she ran and she heard Peter's voice. The girl got so excited, she turned around and ran back into the house. She didn't even open the door for Peter. She was excited. She was ready to go tell the saints of God, come see what the Lord has done. Your prayers have been answered. She ran back into the house. But You see, Herod wanted to kill Peter. It was the next morning he was going to kill Peter. But because the saints were praying, Peter was set free from jail. There's some children sitting beside you. I'm looking around in this place. There's some children that's sitting beside you. There ain't no doubt in my mind. Because you see, I was a bad boy when I was growing up. I was a headache. I was a handful. My mama couldn't do anything with me sometimes. And some of y'all feel the same about your children. But I just stopped by to tell you to keep on praying. Keep on praying. Keep on praying. Keep on praying. Because I am a product of prayer. You see, if the mothers would not have prayed for me, if the pastor would not have prayed for me, I would have been just like James. I would have been dead. I would have been somewhere in hell. You gotta keep on praying. God is coming to your rescue. God is coming to answer your prayer. Keep on praying. I am a product of much prayer. I did not want salvation. If you would have told me about 20 years ago that I wouldn't be a preacher today, I would have probably put out my gun and shot you. I didn't want to be a saint, no less preaching the word of God. But I heard the preacher on this morning said it was in God's plan that I be a preacher, that I carry his word. Some of those kids that you call it hard head, some of those ones that you seem to can't get to do right, it's in their plan. It's in God's plan for them. And they're going to carry the word of God. You just keep on praying and watch what I tell you. I sold drugs. I had gang activity. I lied, I cheated, I stole. I got shot at, I did some shooting. But somebody was praying for me. Her name was Mother Lily Williams and Mother Annie Mallard and the late Mother Bell. They was praying for me. Because you see, one time they cornered me in my yard and they told me, they said, son, we're praying for you. We're praying that God would bring you out. You better keep on praying. I don't care what those kids are doing right now. You keep on praying. I'm a product of prayer. And if you keep on praying, I'm bound to tell you that wait on tomorrow. Wait on tomorrow. They're going to come back to you. And they're going to give you the word of God. Keep on praying.
Back and get you.
This is the NYPU session, and that's where I'm just talking about your children. But I want the saints of God to know too that whatever it is that you're praying for, God has heard your prayers. He's heard your cry, and he's coming to see about you. You see, in our scripture text, when Peter was broken out of prison, it did not let us know what time of day it was, but I know the awesomeness of God. And if you ask Paul and Silas, they will probably tell you it was midnight when Peter was busted out of prison. If you ask her and Mallard, I can tell you it was midnight. It was midnight when God came to deliver me. It was midnight when God came to see about me. Keep on praying. I'm closing down. Let us all stand to our feet. I'm closing now, because society is trying to give our children up. If they get in a little bit of trouble, and I'm not a doctor, I'm not going to try to go against what the doctor told you, but I find in my studies that they're sticking them on Ritalin.
Yeah.
A little bit of trouble. They say, go get a prescription written, everything will be all
right.
They're trying to give our children up. But I stop by to tell you to keep on praying. Because the children is our future. They are our future. And we can't give up on them. While we're standing, every one of the children get in the aisle. Every one of the children, if you're on the aisle, you see it by the hour, and you got some children in your row, step out and let them all come out in the hour. Let them all come out in the hour.
Oh, I can't.
And even in technology, I can say that it can be one of the most powerful ways to witness. But the enemy knows how to stop a witness. So they use the technology for all kind of things, but witness it up to God. So they try things that I haven't tried before. Let them all out in the house. Let everyone get out, get out, get out. Keep on praying. Now, if you're on the aisle road, I want you to just reach out and grab one of the hands of the children. Slide over to the aisle and grab the hand of that person that has the hand of a child. It's prayer time. It's prayer time. And every child in the aisle, with your free hand, put your hand on the shoulder of the person in front of you. I know what prayer can do. You see that pretty woman I had to stand up that I called my wife? Let me tell you something. Could you calm the music down just a little bit? Let me tell you something. And we're going to pray. But that pretty woman I called my wife, one day we were riding along, and I think I just told her this recently. Back in high school, we was riding alone. I had already went to the military, and I came home on leave. And we was riding alone in my sister's gray Honda Accord. I remember it like it was yesterday. And I had got me a 9mm. My nephew had purchased a 9mm because he and I was only a couple years apart. Because I'm the last one of eight. So my mom and dad thought they were done when they had me, but I came along. So me and my nephew was only a couple years apart. And when I went away to the military, he had purchased his 9mm. Me and my wife was riding along in the back seat. And I cocked that 9mm. Came unloaded. I let her see me cock it. But I dropped the clip. But before I dropped the clip, I guess I must have hit it again. Wasn't paying attention. But I thought I dropped the clip, and I thought I dropped the round that was in the chamber. But I didn't. The devil had been putting in my mind, do so, show how bad you are. Take that gun, put it to your head, pull the trigger. He had been putting it in my mind. God can work. I'm a product. But you see, God stepped in, and he had me to pull the trigger of the gun before I put it to her head. And it went off. And we had that much gap in the window we were sitting by. It went off, had every one of our ears in the car ringing. And my nephew slammed on brakes because he thought I had been killed her. I thought I had been killed her. But God had it that the bullet flew out the window. I know what prayer can do. I know what prayer can do. You gotta keep on praying for them. I don't care what they do. Keep on praying for them. And be parent, not friend. Be their parent, not their friend. And I believe that God can set them free. I got many stories I can tell, but I don't have the time right now because we're going to pray on behalf of these children. Can I get my ministry brother to come, those that are in here? Come to the front, come to the front. Now, we're not going to individually pray for every child, but I believe that what God has given me, we have formed a wall on this afternoon. We have formed a wall that this prayer is going to break through this line that we have in the middle aisle. And these kids are going to be set free. You're not going to have to worry about them anymore. They're going to be set free. Keep on praying, mama. Keep on praying, father. Touch your mother right there on your shoulder. Everybody touch somebody. Everybody touch somebody. This is the prayer for our children. This is the altar call for our children. Because I know what prayer can do. It was prayer that brought me through. Let us bow our heads. Lord Jesus Christ, Father, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for this day and this opportunity, oh Lord, that you're giving to us to pray for our children, oh Lord. So Father, we're looking unto you, and we ask that you'll send a miracle down this middle aisle, oh Lord. That whatever our children are facing, Lord, that the enemy won't be able to let it live up to come song, oh Lord. Touching the three on this.